Ništa, hvala Katarina, hvala Katja, da ste organizirali ovo super srečanje. Srečanje misli zapravo za mene. I super je biti ovako na kraju, jer imaš već sve te, mislim, vidiš kako se povezivaju sve te naše misli. Svako nešto izloži neki aspekt, ali nekako na kraju ćemo vidjeti da imamo, mislim, da ćemo stvoriti neku zajedničku misao na kraju. Mislim, ja već osjetim to. I da, mogu iskoristiti sad to moju poziciju samo za jedan koment na to pitanje identifikacije koje je kružilo sve vreme. Za mene to izbjegavanje imaginarne identifikacije sa tim ubijanjem tih svojih karaktera i isto, na primjer, s tim, ja mislim da je to ista stvar je sa tim pitanjem identifikacije geja ili te gej scene sa njegovom izjavom da je zapravo transseksualac. Ili, ne, ja, biseksualac, da, izvinjavam se, ali bio i, mislim, i sad, i bio je transseksualac, ali izjava je bila tada. Ne, šta sam htjela da kažem je da pitanje odnosa, sad ću probati još na hrvatskom, mada mi je mislim, nije tako lako, ali svejedno, pitanje odnosa između simbolne, između imaginarne identifikacije i simbolnog, ja mislim da, i tu je pitanje za tebe, Katarina, ali možda na kraju, ja mislim da u simbolnom identifikacija ne postoji. Ja mislim da je simbolno baš simbolno, lakanovsko simbolno, je baš ta nemogućnost identifikacije. Mislim, i znamo da imaginarno i simbolno su samo dva stava jednog istog sistema, iste strukture. Ali ja mislim da unutar te imaginarna logika je logika identifikacije sa objektom A, malim objektom A. A simbolno je baš to pređenje same mogućnosti identifikacije. Znači, simbolno kaže identifikacija sa drugim nije moguća i to je ta veliki drugi koji, ta neki drugi sa kojim ne postoji identifikacija. I šta sam Bovi kao fenomen realizira je za mene baš to. Baš to ne odvojenje od imaginarne i simbolne logike, nego njuno, kako se kaže to, merge, spajanje. On kao fenomen pokaziva da su imaginarno i simbolno dve strane istog procesa. Mislim, i on zapravo otvara ta simbolni red, ali baš kao nemogućnost identifikacije. Ok, to je bio samo neka misao, ali sad, evo, i ja počnem sa Saints. Kako se kaže Saints? Svecom. Ok. Ja ću malo čitat, pa malo ću se referirat, malo ću slobodno pričat, pa tako. Sad pređem na engleski. Ok, jedan intro, pa ću ga pročitat. There was a massively visited group exhibition last spring at Stefan Romano Gallery in Brooklyn entitled Saint Bowie, which presented reliquaries, ex voto santos, sigils, altars, efforts, spirit photos, and other objects dedicated to communing with Bowie on the other side. On Pinterest, you can find over 1,000 images about Saint Bowie, including a photo of a best-selling Saint Bowie prayer candle, a beautiful vintage upcycled plate, Rest in Peace, David, and a bunch of similar stuff. It's only forever, not long at all. Saint David Bowie will always live on, they say on Pinterest. Of course, this kind of an artistic and popular canonization only continues with David Bowie's own game. Remember, for example, the All Saints album. And nobody takes it for real. But on the other hand, isn't this precisely the structure of every canonization? Everybody knows, everybody says it, but still, svi kažu on nije saint, but still, no? Everybody knows David Bowie was not a saint proper. He was probably just a Nazi devil, as some quasi-leftist populists have recently remarked. Of course not. Everybody knows David Bowie was not a saint. He was just an ordinary man, a working class man who accidentally became a pop star. The first thing to stress here is that our awareness of David Bowie not being a saint cannot bring us to the simple conclusion that he was just an ordinary man. Quite the opposite. David Bowie was not a saint, not because he was just a man, but precisely because he was not a man. Why? A saint is nothing but a divinized human, and David Bowie wasn't human in the first place. So what was he? An alien? A starman? Perhaps. But let us rather call him an anti-human. Or we can even say he was a superhuman, that is, if we consider a superhuman to be a nobody who from his empty guts draws the power to create his own face. In this sense, David Bowie was an artist. In Lacanian words, we could say he was a player with a screen. What he was and what he still is a proper realization of the Lacanian theory of the subject, abandoning every trace of a self, every trace of the self, every crumb of the core identity of a man. Let us establish the face as a formal structure, as a certain historical arising, as a concept connected to the journey of certain coagulations of thought most strongly present in the 20th century, whose subterranean seething began at least a couple of centuries ago. The inhuman in human beings, that is what the face is, write Deleuze and Guattari. In any case, that which is inhuman is in relation to the human a surplus, a monster, or an exception understood either as its lack or as its excess. Inhuman is that which in a certain way sticks out of the human, that does not fit or suit a human. On the other hand, the inhuman is necessarily connected to the human. As that certain something it has to exceed, surpass, or remain from. Inhuman is something that evidently steps out of that apology of man, which is, in the broader sense, captured under the common concept of humanism. This step out can occur in an uncovered or a covered way, as a clearly expressed anti-humanism, or as a menacing backside of the humanism that we can nowadays, in the time of a reign of a democratic humanitarian humanism, observe as its obscene side product. The inhuman can be understood as a superhuman, as that which comes out of a dead man and encourages him to create himself anew, or as a subhuman, base and animal, as that which makes man unworthy of his name. The essential misunderstanding on the basis of which the advocates of contemporary humanism justify their actions is in the constant confusion of the two mentioned variants of inhumanity. They refer to the bestiality of subhumanity to justify the advance of humanism, whilst deliberately overlooking the positive power of the superhuman. When a revealed anti-humanism is thwarted with big words about human rights and the untouchability of an individual, it turns against humanism with all force as a concealed subhuman arrow of evil, as its own uncontrolled beast. Before we take a further look at inhumanity, we must first turn to what we call humanity, to the human in man. Let us assume that man is human only when inseparably connected to God. This means that real humanism is possible only in the context of Christianity. It is the humanism that Badiou calls classical metaphysical humanism, which according to him exists only as long as a minimal, this is a quote, a minimal undecidability circulates between man and God. A man has no face. His gaze is directed at God, and the divine eye turns back to his visage. So I'm actually opposing the concept of a face to the concept of a visage, and actually connecting the idea of humanism with the concept of a visage, and the idea of anti-humanism with the concept of a face. And I'll just try to elaborate on this a bit. So the visage is a closed structure of otherness that can be disclosed only against the background of a certain substantiality. Sorry. Every intersubjective relationship within Christianity is a copy of this primary relationship between man and God. A man looking at man's visage is always a man looking at the visage of God, or God looking at the visage of man. According to Levinas, the visage is the otherness of the other as an intersection of infinite closeness and infinite distance. This is precisely the fundamental structure of the human divine gaze. This structure is always unique. There is no space for the generic. Man looking at God is always an individual that gains God's gaze meant exclusively for him. This uniqueness is, of course, the fundamental illusion of this supposition. Every man is worth the attention of God, which means that every man deserves to be a man. It is precisely this Christian disposition that is called compassion. The visage is always connected to the idea of a man advocated by humanism, by both classical metaphysical humanism, which since the birth of the modern subject started slowly losing its content related to the concept of the sacred, as well as the radical humanism of some of the philosophical currents of the 20th century, attempting to place man on the empty divine throne. And this is actually Badiou's elaboration. He, in the book of the 20th century, and he is putting this, he says that, for example, hermeneutics and existentialism are actually the last extension of theoretical humanism. Maybe not the last, we don't know this, but the extension of humanism towards actually the new philosophical currents that established anti-humanism as such as structuralism and French school and so on. And last but not least, also contemporary humanitarian humanism intensively crawling through numerous paratheoretical media political channels. Man has a visage, and this is always some kind of a likeness. The undecidability of the man-God relationship is delineated precisely against the background of their original likeness. God created man in his image, which is why man shows his gratitude by always establishing himself according to his likeness to the Maker. For him, this is simultaneously a privilege and an infinite obligation. As long as the privilege, which means being chosen by God, and the obligation, obedience to God, are in proportion, man lives in peace, caring for God and the fellow man. But when, in the name of the obligation, his privileges spread to all sides, when God is established as the only and general model for any kind of a likeness, man is prepared to kill in the name of God. Then the privilege is embodied in the sentence, "Who is not like God is not really human." Here we can clearly see what lies at the core of David Bowie's glorification and divinization.
nothing more than a violent humanization, a disposition of the visage reducing him to the basically Christian structure of a superstar. He's not a saint because he's just an ordinary man. This is a blasphemous humanitarian exposition of so many pop stars. I'm just one of you, so close that we can stare into each other's eyes, and yet so far that you can feel my omnipresent divine gaze all around you. David Bowie never accepted this kind of comfort. Rather, he aimed beyond, towards the uncertain terrain of inhumanity. A likeness is never merely a surface, but always has a background, a content. Namely, it cannot exist merely by itself, for it would be as such too fragile and superficial. Every likeness has a depth. A likeness is filled with meaning, with a truth and a sense. Precisely because a likeness carries something, hides something in the background, it can be interpreted over and over again. A likeness is a metaphor calling for an exegesis. Is this? Exegesis. Exegesis. And what else is the history of Christian teachings but a repeated interpretation of the same metaphors and images? And here I can refer, of course, to this critic of interpretation from Tomislav. A likeness is like something, not like nature, but like an idea. It is like its own depth, its own sense. We can thus see that the undecidable relationship between man and God, founded in the corresponding of their likeness, is never merely an external relation of copying and mirroring in its classical pre-Lacanian sense, but is always happening as immanence. It is precisely this internalization of the relation of likeness that the New Testament illustrated with Christ. God was incarnated to cover his likeness with that of a man. Every man is in his essence an incarnation of God. God is an interpretative content of the human likeness, and vice versa, man is the interpretative content of God's likeness. The two likenesses overlap and create depth in their mutual relation of likeness. Still, this overlapping can never be complete, for likeness is a relation which is always constituted by a certain minimal difference. Indistinguishability of man and God necessarily means also their immense difference. The immenseness of difference, interpreted as infinity, eternity, and immortality, always implies a certain immeasurability. That the difference in relation of likeness between man and God is immeasurable is the deepest essence of the relationship, which is also what Badiou's term undecidability aims at. To demolish this relationship, which can in no way be determined or formalized, but can only be infinitely interpreted, a radical move is needed that abolishes the difference, thus crashing the likeness to sameness with one stroke. The abolishment of the difference can happen as an abolishment of the likeness that constituted it. In the history of philosophy, this radical gesture, a decision at the place of undecidability, happened as Nietzsche's declaration of God's death. The undecidable predicate between the human and the divine manifested as a history of immanence, and reversibly between the idea of the humanizing God and that of the divinizing man is, as we mentioned, according to Badiou, the essence of classical metaphysical humanism. This was sentence was so long that even I don't understand it right now. But okay, Nietzsche's project is exactly the break of this predicate, a decision at the point of the undecidable. The declaration God is death, coming at the time of the most undecidable connection between man and God, brings with a drastic consequence, namely that because of the indistinguishability, men die together with the Maker. Only against the background of their death, only at the point when they both vanished into nothingness, could the difference between them be abolished. Between nothing and nothing, there is no difference. There is pure sameness, emptiness, a gap. Immortality is no more. With it, the likeness has also disappeared. Man will have to be replaced by someone that can live without God. This someone will be named Superman. Man is a natural or a divine givenness, whereas Superman is a program, a self-creation without substantial presuppositions arising from nothing existing inasmuch as he succeeds in realizing himself. Again, the superhuman is a nobody who from his empty guts drew the power to create his own face. And what is the stance of anti-humanism? The emergence from nothing, the idea that takes place through the thought and actions of the 20th century, represents a certain radical confrontation with the structure of reality. This stance could be clearly separated from the perspective of a desperate nihilism or melancholy. Today, more than ever, we should be aware of the positive power of negation. We should ignore the criticism that understands negation as nihilistic, depressive, counterproductive. Negation, if anything, is productive, and it is precisely here, not in its allegedly destructive force, that lies its greatest danger. For the capitalist monetary mechanism and the consumerist economy are riding this horse well. Therefore, the crucial task for the left-wing politics today is not to detect and condemn every trace of Nazism, even in the thin white Duke, but to find out how to subsume and lead this horse of productive negation. The major task of left-wing politics today is to invent an alternative channeling of the power of negation, a new regulation of the force of production.
And here we are again at the question of the new and the possibility of a revolution. We should strive towards a turn within the very concept of humanism, which proves to be nothing more than the flip side of the history of Western imperialism, abused by the rhetoric of the post-industrial capitalist economy. A new channeling of the power of negation is the major task of anti-humanism. And here, we can speak about a living out of death. Not so much in the sense of the Heideggerian being toward death, and definitely not in the vitalistic sense, but in the sense of understanding the power of the gap, of walking on the borderline, of facing the lack and the exception, and confronting the burden of anti-humanism in the sense of insisting on one's desire. This is what David Bowie was dealing with throughout his many deaths, constantly reinventing his own face. And I think today this is our bet, not a denial, but a confrontation, not a final destruction, but a deconstruction for the purpose of a new construction, a creation of the world out of desire. And I really like the one graffiti, which I don't know whether it was Croatian or Serbian, but it said it was circling kružio po Facebooku, ne znam što da ste videli šta želja zna šta je nemoguće. Znači, following one's desire is not a desperate surrender to the endless circulation around the object, the surrender to the impossibility of reaching the goal, but the power of the instant attempting precisely not to reach the goal, but to strive towards its aim instead, which is nothing but the aim to transcend its own logic, the logic of its own impossibility. For precisely its own impossibility is the desire's fundamental condition of possibility. And this is the driving force of desire, the positive productive power of negation inscribed within its repetition. Of course, the question lingers whether
Of course, the question lingers whether David Bowie was riding this power of negation in serving the consumerist logic of the pop sphere, or was he really standing for anti-humanism? Did he stand for a different use of the productive power of negation in a political way? In a way, I don't know if this is a relevant question, and I don't have an answer. I can just maybe remember Lacan's remark on Freud's thought about several artists who managed to make money out of their own desire. And I'm quoting Lacan, quoting Freud, actually. If a creation of desire, which is pure at the level of the painter, takes on commercial value, and this is a gratification that may all the same be termed secondary, it is because its effect has something profitable for society, for that part of society that comes under its influence. I think this is a crucial sentence, actually. Maybe I should repeat it once more. If a creation of desire, which is pure at the level of the painter, takes on commercial value, it is because its effect has something profitable for society, for that part of society that comes under its influence. And I think here, my thought would be that it's not about my thought on this possible revolution of today is that the thing is not to desire a revolution, but to desire the desire itself, to stay within this drive of the desire, and to let it go. I think this is, I don't know. For David Bowie, I mean, for me, what is relevant is not his, like, proclaimed political, I don't know, stance, but the very fact that he didn't surrender, that he kept jumping through this crack in the sky, bringing in the light over and over again. To me, this is much more than any political statement, and it is an action that has certain effects. And it is about activity, as you were speaking before, Katya, I think, about taking this passive state into your own hands, like to be active in this passive state.
To subjectivize your subject.
Yeah, for example. I remember this feeling we shared with David Bowie's death. It was some friends of mine were describing his death as if one color had disappeared from this world, or as if the world suddenly and irreparably became darker. It was really some kind of common feeling in this structure of the world that lost, I don't know, whom, no? Maybe a saint, or I don't know, a Christ. I'll skip this part because it's too much. I'll just go for the last thing. So again, I'm coming back to this concept of the face and the visage. So the face is not a likeness. It is an invention, a monster, an exception. The face is a surface, but the surface of the screen. The face functions precisely in the Lacanian realm of the scopic drive, within the split of the gaze and the eye. As we know, for Lacan, a drive is a montage, a symbolic construct. There is nothing natural in the function of the drive. And in the scopic field, the gaze performs the function of the object A. This is the gaze that ego imagines in the field of the other. The split of the gaze and the eye is the split between that which represents the subject and that which triggers it. And there is one very interesting elaboration in Lacan in this four concept of psychoanalysis. According to Lacan, actually the scopic field merges the two triangle systems. The one that in the geometrical field puts in our place the subject of the representation, and the second that is that which turns me into a picture. I'll just try to explain with my own words to be more understandable, and then I'll read what it's written. So he's... Zapravo Lacan priča o tome, ne, da sta dva, da ta scopic field, ne, da je konstituiran iz dveh trokuta. I zapravo prvi trokut je ta klasičan trokut fenomenalnega subjekta. Znači, ja sam ta koji gledam, ja sam ta ki vidim, znači moja sa jedne tačke i tako gre ta trokut, ne? I sa druge strane je ta image, slika, ali nije to isto ko slika, znači image i picture, sta dva koncepta, ne? Znači tu je image, ta picture, no picture, sorry, image, ta podoba, kako se kaže podoba?
Lik,
na primer, kako si ja predstavljam svet, ne? To je ta fenomenalna pač kantovska transcendentalni, mislim, ta pač. Ja, hvala. To kako ja vidim svet, to je svet je moja predstava, ne? Je to nas predučba. World is my representation, no? So this is this classical trokut. Classical triangle, sorry. And then we have a Lacanian triangle and he actually, what he does is he splits the function, he turns things upside down, actually following Merleau-Ponty. He says that the world is the one who is watching us, and I'm making myself a picture. So it's the opposite. It's the opposite, and he's putting then those triangles like this. So they are overlapping, but they are pointing into different directions, no? So and what? Ne, imam ovdje, le. Čekaj, ja sam ovdje. Nisam...
S prstima nije baš.
Vidjet ćeš tu, čekaj. Ne, izvini, ne, nije bilo baš dobro s prstima, ovako je.
S prstima,
tako je, ne.
Ovako je, znači ne možeš to s prstima.
Da. I šta je zanimivo, da Lacan nije samo obrnuo stvari kao Merleau-Ponty, nego on kaže da dva trikuta tvore ta scopic field. Which means that at the same time that I'm putting myself into the position of the one who is seeing and who is representing himself, representing the world to himself as an image, at the same time I'm making myself a picture, and the world is watching me through so many spots of the gaze. So the gaze is all over and it's watching me, no? So the both processes are going on together. And
gledam, ja sam gledan.
Da. Ja gledam, ja sam gledan. Ali to da sam gledanje uvek pre ne, da prethajano how to say in English?
Prethodi
to da ja gledam, ne? I ta the surface of the image and the surface of me becoming a picture over the screen are overlapping. So this screen and the image of the world are overlapping. But this overlapping, of course, is never total. Like it's never successful. It's always a kind of slip in between this. And this is this function of the slepilo.
Lure.
Yes. Now I'm going to read it to be more accurate. So, the first triangle stems from the classical account of the phenomenal subject. I am the one who sees, and the world is nothing but a representation, an image produced from the singular point of my perception. The second triangle turns this perspective upside down. It sets the gaze on the other side, away from the perspective point of the phenomenal subject. Here the gaze is no longer the function of the subject, using the eye as the organ of perception, but is set opposite the subject. In the second triangle, the subject is the one that is seen, and it is seen by the many-pointed structure of the gaze. The subject itself becomes a picture, letting itself be seen, but only in the way of having always already been seen. If we superimpose the two triangles in the opposite direction, their intersection produces a screen image. The phenomenal representation and the screen through which I let myself be seen overlap. This overlapping, of course, can function only through a certain shift in a certain faltering. And this is why Lacan says that the relation between the gaze and what one wishes to see involves a lure. The subject is presented as other than he is, and what one shows him is not what he wishes to see. So, one last thing. At the same time, the face is a fundamental image. It is a fundamental image not because it establishes a basic cultural pattern, but because it installs the screen itself. The face is a visual network of signifiers strung around the anchor signifier that has occupied its place contingently, with no deeper reason. However, this doesn't prevent it from functioning as a trigger, as a cause. This construction, this collage, this visual network of signifiers is set and reset in every moment. There is no continuity. But this doesn't mean that there is no logic behind it. Quite the opposite. What seems like a pure accident has actually a strong causal structure. But this structure can never work as a law. It cannot be generalized precisely because of its discontinuity. Therefore, the face is not timeless. On the contrary, it is out of time. In every single moment, it arises anew, each time establishing the screen that projects the split between how I let myself be seen and how others see me. The visage, on the other hand, presupposes a continuity that establishes a certain predestined identity, an identity of the self that in its optic illusion of uniqueness serves as a representative of a vast generalization, a generalization of the timeless image of a human and his predispositions defined by law. The moral law, the law of duty, the law of love, the law of compassion, the law of mercy, the law of freedom, all this is the law that creates the general visage of humanism, the visage of Jesus Christ. The ultimate perversion of humanitarian humanism as the obscene leftover of the noble idea of human rights. It is as noble as it is exalted, actually. It's such a play with the screen that establishes itself as a visage, as a fixed reflective relation between the subject's gaze stemming from the eye as an organ of as an organ, and God's gaze originating in his all-seeing eye, and denies the very schism, the split between the eye and the gaze. That is the schism that establishes the screen as such in the first place. So what is a superstar, a pop icon? It is nothing but the establishment of the visage through the play with the screen. And this is the game David Bowie didn't go for. Rather, he was a constructor of the face, catching its productive power, taking its advantage as the constitutive moment of the traumatic crack of anti-human subjectivity. Yes, and this is the end.